Hello, Mrs. Catherton.
Can I come round and show you the pamphlets for the fete?
Yeah. Just let yourself in, OK? I've just got to do a piece to camera. See you later. Our world today is safer than it's ever been. Certainly safer than it was in medieval times. There's no packs of wolves roaming the countryside, gobbling villagers whole and then dabbing their lips dry on the nearest bit of tapestry. No bubonic plague blackening your fingertips and then turning your armpits into putrefied pockets of human wax. No witch finders killing your wife. These days, we've got it easy and there's ever so little to be frightened of.
But the moment they appear on TV, even the quaintest surroundings can suddenly seem dramatically more dangerous.
The peaceful county of Devon is home to one of England's largest fireworks factories. But the tranquility is shattered when a tiny spark sets off 18,000 pounds of explosives.
Television's slightly hysterical take on the world has a way of colouring your everyday experience, as we'll see throughout this series. It often functions as a magic mirror, providing an endless stream of mesmerising unpleasantness. It shows you arresting tales of gory, bloody murder.
Imagine the height of the backswing to get spray marks that long.
Horrifying visions of mankind's inevitable demise. Eerily disturbing imagery designed to sell you protection.
So who knows what your family could be eating?
And more petrifying news coverage than you can shake a fear stick at.
Is Britain sliding toward chaos?
No wonder all these people are so terrified on the inside. They're not even safe in their own homes as they sit there staring at a machine that warns them worse is to come.
This week, how TV ruined your life by shouting boo in your mind. Don't say it didn't, it did.
It can happen anywhere, to anyone. An ordinary street, a moment's thoughtlessness.
That's a characteristically cheerful public information film, or PIF, one of many thousands of government-approved mini-horror movies designed to fear you into not going all dead.
Mike, look out!
Early public information films consisted of patronising cartoons.
A bicycle isn't at all under control when ridden freehand.
Hysterical bollockings.
Polish a floor, put a rug on it. You might as well set a man trap.
Or cautionary tales which simply barked at you like a Joe Budner.
Hey, what do you think you're doing? Come back here.
Go on, Joe, knock some sense into them.
If you go on like that, you could be in big trouble.
You know, it's a bit rich taking health and safety advice from a man who hits people in the face for a living. Effectively, this was the man using television to command you, the citizen, to behave for your own good.
That's better. Be smart. Be safe.
This man was safe. Until now.
In the late 20th century, one of the greatest challenges facing the UK was the population's apparent ignorance of how a new technology known as electricity worked.
And anyone who touches him also gets a shock.
Compounding the issue, this widespread lack of knowledge coincided with a nationwide craze for leisure activities involving long conductive objects.
Watch out!
Oh, God!
Those wires alive!
If you want to have fun and stay alive, keep away from overhead power lines.
Yeah, and if you want to have fun but you're not fussed about staying alive, buy a kite. Simply wouldn't have happened if he'd used a wooden kite. Idiot. In the light of such carnage, playing with an object not directly attached to your hands might have seemed like a sensible option, unless, like famous electrocution victim Jimmy, you lobbed it up a substation and got pussy-whipped into retrieving it.
Go on, get it.
Pass me that bit of wood.
Careful, Jimmy, you don't want to get splinters breaking into that high-voltage substation. Oh, yeah. Now you cry. A minute ago, it was all, oh, go and get it, Jimmy. Oh, do it for me, Jimmy. I mean, I'd call her a typical woman, but she isn't. She's just a horrid little girl. Anyway, against the odds, Jimmy survived that incident and is still alive today.
People still bring up the whole Frisbee thing.
And I mean, yeah, it stung a bit, obviously, but it wasn't as grievous as they made out in the film. In some ways, having 66,000 volts zip through you can be quite pleasant. I actually work in toy design now. We're trying to create a less aerodynamic Frisbee to protect future generations. Me and Sal are still together. We really bonded after the accident, much as my trainers bonded to my feet due to the intense heat generated.
As we've seen, many early piffs had a nakedly bossy hue. But today the establishment holds less sway and the man in the street no longer responds to the voice of authority ordering them about.
What would you say if David Cameron told you not to throw a Frisbee up a pylon?
I'd do it anyway.
Hence, piffs have changed tack and the authoritarian instruction has largely been removed, leaving behind nothing but cold horror in its wake. Today's piffs are little more than a ruthless cavalcade of raw physical horror, gory slapstick and jaw-droppingly morbid appeals to personal guilt. Ah, oh, typical kids today, just lying around. Peek-a-boo! Cheer up, mate. At least you got a free draft excluder out of it. But in our putrid modern hell, it's not just cars and pylons that'll hurt you. No, you're a danger to yourself. If you're not puffing your way to a personal clogged pipe Armageddon, you're boozing yourself dumb and tumbling from a scaffold, or Pete Doherty-ing yourself before heading out on the tiles. Rather than using calm reason, most corrective television uses fear to hammer its message home. It's one of the most powerful ways to grab an audience's attention. But why?
Well, for one thing, no matter how sophisticated we humans appear to be with our fancy shoes and Nintendo Wiis and whatnot, our brains are still cursed with a paleo-mammalian limbic system which the modern iPad-owning part of us can't control.
Our fear responses are governed by twin almond-shaped clusters of nuclei known as the amygdalae, sort of primitive reactionary mind nuts beyond the reach of human intellect, a bit like TalkSport presenters.
The point of the amygdalae is essentially protection.
You're supposed to be stimulated when confronted by a loud noise or a sudden movement because, well, it could be a lion leaping in to attack you. That's why it's almost impossible to ignore anything which seems like a threat, be it a lion or a scary newsreader.
A strong possibility of attack.
The spectre of Irish terrorism returns to British soil.
The amygdalae are also thought to be closely associated with memory, so if you have an unpleasant experience and your amygdalae are stimulated, an association quickly forms in your head.
That's why the man uses scare tactics to mould your behaviour from an early age. But when you're a kid, it's not just the stuff that's meant to be frightening that's frightening. That's because children's entertainment has long been a quite hideously disturbing carnival of grotesque imagery, and kids' TV is no different. When I was a child, I was scared of all manner of ostensibly innocent things, such as the manic cackling witch Fenella, who lent an air of demented menace to the otherwise charming Chalton and the Wheelies. Then there was Pipkins, a downbeat lo-fi take on Sesame Street, in which a gang of grimy puppets who seemed to be living in some kind of squat wrestled with existential dilemmas.
Why do people have to die? Why can't they just live forever?
Because that's the way it is, Topoff. Everything and everybody has to die. That's just the way it is. Look, I'm going to put the kettle on and make a cup of tea. Sure you'll feel better after that.
God, and if the concept of death has blown Topov's mind, imagine how he'll react when he realises he can't taste that cup of tea because his tongue's made of felt. My enjoyment of the ostensibly harmless Jigsaw was also tempered by regular sightings of Mr. Nosybonk, a walking phallic symbol who appeared to have stepped straight out of a prepubescent nightmare. A lot of kids' TV was so creepy it sometimes seemed the people behind it were deliberately trying to scare the viewer with eerie imagery, and the scarier a kids' show was, the more likely it'll have lodged in our collective memory. I'm talking, of course, about All Of.
Do you remember All Of?
Yeah.
It was a kind of egg-shaped thing. And just for the purposes of this, could you say that you do remember it?
Okay.
Yeah. Do you remember All Of?
Yeah, I remember him.
What did he look like?
Shape of an egg.
And now on BBC One, egg-shaped animation which everyone in the nation is certain to remember in 30 years' time. All Of.
Ah, All Of.
just enjoying an afternoon snooze. Someone's not happy. That's his nest. What's going on in that little bird's mind? I suppose all animals are ultimately unknowable, even our parents. Little birdie's going up top, and he's got an audience. We're all passive observers of what follows. I wouldn't do that. Now, everything is over. The actors leave the stage.
Yes, during my formative years, mushroom clouds were all the rage.
Britain's doctors say 33 million people in this country may be killed and injured in a nuclear war.
To my babyish eyes, it seemed every news bulletin consisted of nuclear paranoia, Mrs. Thatcher, blood-curdling statistics about the inevitable apocalypse. And the only people trying to stop this madness seemed to be kindly dinner ladies and lofty off EastEnders.
If we have got peace camps, non-violent direct action outside every nuclear base in this country, they can't shift us.
Yeah, except maybe with water cannons or tasers or bulldozers. Or I suppose they could always just walk in and physically pick you up. What I'm saying is they can shift you. Despite the high stakes, however, it was hard for the average viewer to picture a nuclear war. I mean, we'd seen what happened in Hiroshima, but that was black and white and crackly and seemed to mainly affect Japanese people living in the 1940s, so it didn't really count. What the average Brit needed was a no-nonsense visual guide to what could happen, and hallelujah, that's precisely what they got. In 1982, the BBC broadcast a QED special called A Guide to Armageddon, which simulated the consequences of one megaton nuclear bomb going pop a mile over St Paul's Cathedral. Apparently, the heat alone would be inconsiderate enough to slightly damage the cross on top of St Paul's, spoil a few windows, leave a Bible looking dog-eared, slightly devalue the contents of the National Gallery, and boil the Serpentine a bit. It would be bad news for anyone who enjoys not burning to death in an incinerated car or bus, and even if you live 4 miles away and were hiding indoors, it was probably going to go down as one of your least favourite afternoons, especially if you've been looking forward to reading Woman's Own. In fact, if you were even vaguely nearby, your body would frazzle like a carbonised lamb chop unless you were standing as far away as Wimbledon, at which point at least one of your eyebrows would survive. Yeah, it looks pretty nasty, but the ladies love a war wound, yeah? You'd be beating them off with a stick. Albeit a burnt, smouldering, radioactive stick. Anyway, in case you're worried the situation seems hopeless, the show went on to highlight some of the defensive measures the average 1980s couple could take. Following the helpful Protect and Survive pamphlet, the duo whitewash their windows and construct a bijou shelter under the stairs, perfect for enjoying a cup of tea in. And they fare pretty well.
The whitewash keeps 80% of the heat out. There may be fires in unprotected houses nearby, but Joy and Eric should survive. At least for 17 seconds. After that, the blast demolishes their terrace of houses.
The QED Atomic Splattacular proved so entertaining it convinced the BBC to make Threads, possibly the most frightening drama ever broadcast on British television. Threads graphically depicted how a nuclear bomb could cause millions of pounds worth of improvement to Sheffield's architecture. The moment of detonation itself was brilliantly realised, rammed with stark, horrifying images that set amygdala across the nation lighting up like the residents of Sheffield.
Jesus Christ, Donnie.
And then just when you think things can't get any worse, they do. Because Threads keeps going, trudging into the grim aftermath as Sheffield is transformed into an almost Plymouth-style wasteland in which people eat rats like their cream buns and the cast of Last of the Summer Wine is hopelessly depressed. And even Ron Weasley isn't safe. I guess if Threads had an overall theme, it was, oh, shit! The next morning, BBC reporters descended on Sheffield to gauge how the locals reacted to seeing their homes and workplaces destroyed.
I quite enjoyed it, actually. But,
enjoyed seems a strange word to use of such a harrowing play.
Yeah, it may be, but I didn't find it frightening at all.
At around the same time, the Americans had a pop at nuclear drama themselves with the vaguely more upbeat The Day After, which starred Steve Guttenberg in a tale of everyday burning, screaming Americans. Just like Threads, it depicted billowing mushroom clouds, which looked a bit like the world's grooviest lava lamp. And a hilarious sequence in which a kiddiewink gets a bit too much nuclear war in his eye. Anyway, Steve Guttenberg survives by hiding in a shop. Although the radiation does leave him looking a little less cocksure by the end.
After US President Ronald Reagan saw this, he wrote in his diary that it was very effective and had left him greatly depressed. And not long afterwards, the superpowers adopted a policy of arms reduction, culminating in the signing of the Intermediate Nuclear Arms Force Treaty in Reykjavik.
So in summary, Steve Guttenberg saved the world. Thanks, Steve! Don't make any more films.
Thanks to Gutenberg's selfless sacrifice, today's world isn't facing all-out nuclear war between two superpowers, yet it feels more chaotic and perilous than it did back in the 80s. Perhaps because the presentation of current affairs has become more chaotic and perilous. It's almost a hyper-edited, real-time televisual thriller.
Tonight, can the world come together to confront a rogue nation?
Today, tuning into the news is like looking directly into the face of terror.
A chilling new look tonight at the face of terror. Video of a suicide bomber smiling for the camera as he gets ready for his deadly mission in Afghanistan.
This is like a jihadist 24. It's got that tension in it that you can't really turn yourself away.
And you can't really turn yourself away because you're biologically programmed to pay attention to any potential threat. The amygdala may fire off in response to the pre-programmed terrors we're born with, instinctive fear of loud noises and sudden movements and the like, but it's also easy for them to help us learn to fear almost anything.
Television can certainly condition you to be frightened of all sorts of things. For example, dark city streets. Most of the dark city streets you see are on television. And what's happening in them? Well, usually something awful like a mugging or a murder, or at best a horrific sexual encounter involving a tramp and a bull mastiff if you're watching German television.
In the 1970s, professors George Gerbner and Larry Gross of the University of Pennsylvania carried out pioneering research into the effect of television on viewers. They believed that within a few decades, television had come to enjoy a degree of influence on modern society that was comparable to the power religion held over mankind for centuries.
Gerbner and Gross developed a hypothesis known as cultivation theory. Cultivation theory says that over time, watching television alters a viewer's perception of reality, that their view of the real world starts to march in step with that of the televised one. And the more frequently an image or event is depicted on screen, the greater significance the cultivated viewer attaches to it in the real world. Since much of TV consists of dramatic conflict, violent action, and alarming news coverage, the more you watch, the more passive, nervous, and frightened you become. Gerbner called this mean world syndrome, quite literally the belief that your world has become a mean and frightening place. Gerbner's research appeared to show that heavy viewers often overestimated the amount of risk they faced in everyday life. They were more likely to believe crime rates were rising, even when they were falling, and often thought they were more likely to become victims of crime themselves. And switching it off doesn't make you feel any safer, because now that shut up, you're more aware than ever of the glowering silence all around. What was that? Hello?
Hello? Is there someone there? I'll call the police. Piss.
Crime Watch began in 1984 and was originally fronted by concerned parental types Nick Ross and Sue Cook. They were assisted by an aquarium full of coppers and a duo of plausibly stilted police presenters.
This knife is believed to have been used in the attack.
But the real stars were the accompanying gallery of apparently furious and anonymous men perpetually glaring at you, like the participants in a special Strangeways edition of the board game Guess Who.
Slightly more realistic suspects and actors peopled the rest of the show, popping up in murky CCTV footage and posing for reconstruction snaps like they were modelling the latest in fashionable crime wear. The most frightening crime of all is, of course, murder.
Oh, God!
And there's no danger of a TV murder shortage anytime soon. Not that regular murderers are dangerous enough for the televised world, where they're routinely depicted as criminal geniuses playing a diabolical game of cat and mouse with a troubled police detective wearing the worried expression of a bloodhound opening a court summons. Yes, according to television, most killers are artisan killers whose every offering deserves to be analysed for literary merit, and they're markedly more vicious than almost any of their real-life equivalents. Take the maniac running riot in the inaugural episode of The Dark Moody Wire in the Blood, which featured a madman who specialised in creating diabolical implements of torture in the most upsetting Blue Peter makes ever captured on tape.
Oh, I've got one of those, actually. It's the IKEA Spikensit.
Like the best TV monsters, this killer also sent tapes of his victims to taunt the police.
We've just received this from the post room addressed to Bradfield CID.
Hi. I'm Police Constable Damien O'Connell.
Hi, Damien, how's it going?
Oh, not so good then.
Ah, typical police, sitting on their arse.
Of course, most real-life murderers aren't unstoppable artistic killing machines, but somewhat pathetic individuals who've done something awful in an ill-thought-out panic. And most of them simply don't know what to do after committing their crime. It's not like there's an advice hotline they can turn to.
Welcome back. Now, if you've just joined us, the former Beast of Brighton, rehabilitated murderer Ashley Studd, is answering your queries. So if you've just killed somebody, do call in.
For now, on line three, we've got Sue from Gosforth. Sue, what's happened?
God, it's everywhere. I mean, there's blood everywhere. I can't feel my hands. I don't even know if these are my hands.
Well, Sue, take a step back mentally. Catch your breath. Quieten your mind as much as you can. So, you've literally just murdered someone, have you, Pat?
Yeah, I think...
And everything seems a bit unreal.
Yeah.
Well, that's normal. That's absolutely what I'd expect to find.
His eyes open. His eyes open.
Never mind his eye. That'd stay open even if you sawed his head off. Have you got a top on, a blouse or...
I'm in a T-shirt.
OK, what I want you to do is take it off and drape it over his face. That'll stop you looking in his eye. And we've got to get rid of the clothing you're wearing anyway because of DNA. Can you do that for me?
I'm doing it now.
Good girl.
I can't feel my hands.
What was that, Sue?
She keeps saying she can't feel her hands.
Yes, that's the adrenaline. It's a fascinating mindset. I used to think I could climb into the air in the room or that my brain was made of stallions.
How can it?
Right, now, you need to chuck the rest of your clothes on him, set fire to the house and leave town.
TV loves presenting you with fearful tales of murder, but it's often a curiously reassuring type of fear which reinforces the notion that real life follows a dramatic narrative in which the dastardly villains are brought to justice. When undeniably random bad things do make it on screen, TV processes them on your behalf, turning them into titillation in shows like the enthusiastic 999, which enabled viewers to enjoy mindless emergencies in the comfort of their own homes.
Tonight, the little boy who was swept over a waterfall... and the teenagers who came to the rescue.
Boo!
999 justified its existence by alerting the public to important issues like lifebelt theft.
4,000 lifebelts like this one are stolen or go missing every year.
Yeah, people just toss them in the sea. It's an outrage.
It also afforded Michael Burke an opportunity to ask the important questions.
Have you ever thought what it'd be like to be stuck in the path of a giant digger?
No, why don't you paint a picture for me?
999's jaunty, low-budget reconstructions look altogether genteel compared to the effects-laden reconstruction extravaganzas of today. Shows like Air Crash Investigation, which ostensibly exist to give you a greater insight into airline safety,
but are actually all about giving your fear cells a cheeky tickle. Air Crash Investigation combines impressive special effects with an almost pornographic focus on the human terror of the passengers and crew. There's also dialogue torn from the black box recorder and shoved in the mouths of actors.
Push it up! Push it way up! Way up!
Way up!
Way up!
Hey, you know, there's surprisingly racy dialogue on these black box recorders. In fact, you could probably run an entire adult channel where girls read it out for the benefit of people who can't decide whether they prefer air crashes or masturbating.
Push it up. Push it way up. Way up. Way up.
Anyway, much like the best pornography, Air Crash Investigation features lots of tense stick-gripping action, sweaty shots of a Ron Jeremy type juddering away, and of course the inevitable money shot. Even though you're 20 times more likely to die during the drive to the airport than you are on the plane, chances are this is the kind of dramatic image your brain has helpfully associated with air travel. Apparently concerned it might be running out of nasty real-life threats to warn you about, TV has started visually speculating about bad stuff that hasn't happened but might.
One day, the world will end.
In recent years, there's been a slew of scary, hand-wringing, what-if drama documentaries depicting what could occur if things got even more dangerous for humankind than they already are. We've seen spectacular simulations of what might happen if Yellowstone Park suddenly blew up, hard-hitting investigations into what might happen if the sun suddenly ballooned in size.
This is a world we can barely imagine.
And spine-tingling visualizations of how things might look if a Large Hadron Collider went a bit Amstrad. In fact, it sometimes seems there's no end to TV's perpetual quest to helpfully alert the viewer to new potential threats. In television's hypothetical universe, danger could spring from literally anywhere.
Morning.
Britain's homes and offices contain an estimated 3 billion pens. The rise of computers may have dented their popularity, yet millions of us rely on pens every day. But what would happen if these apparently harmless writing implements turned on their users by heating up inexplicably?
Written communication is one of mankind's greatest achievements. It evolved over centuries, yet today we take it for granted. If our ability to produce handwritten notes were to be affected by an unexpected increase in pen temperature, it could have grave consequences for every man, woman, and child on the planet.
By 10 a.m., manual writing implements nationwide are being hastily abandoned. There are widespread injuries, with casual office doodlers amongst the first casualties. In the markets of Soho, stallholders can no longer price up their vegetables. Fortunately, in today's modern workplace, forgoing pens isn't the hindrance it once was. But by lunchtime, the heat is spreading to computer keyboards.
If typing became impossible, or at best extremely painful, it would transform the online world in an instant. Internet speech would become even more incomprehensible and angry than ever.
Anxious citizens turn to news networks for information. But with no typewritten text on the autocue, news anchors are powerless to help. The government calls an emergency meeting to grab hold of the situation.
Look, we won't get through this by meaninglessly jabbering over each other like dogs on a speedboat. We need to keep a cool head.
Okay, we need to collate what we know. And then...
Disaster strikes at mid-afternoon as people's voices start to get hot. Soon, there will be no way for humans to communicate at all, plunging our planet into a new dark age and eventually causing it to explode altogether.
Alarming though much of television is, as we stare into our screens, desperately gazing into the light like a rodent suckling at a consolatory teat, the warning box is comforting us even as it scares. It says if you obey the man, you can avoid danger. It transforms random calamity into Hollywood-style entertainment, rendering it less real. It says the good guys will defeat the evil guys, and it says Steve Guttenberg can save the world. It makes sense of our universe in a way that's as soothing as it is fake.
Morning!
And what's more, it gets away with it. And that is frightening.
Hugh Dennis and some of the freshest comedy talent around play fast and loose with improvisation Friday at 10 here on BBC Two. And to have a laugh now, BBC Three is the place to be with the lively coming-of-age gang.